There are four pans of liquid. One has water, one has whiskey, one has Coca-Cola, and one has coffee. And now a camel, or a rabbit, or a dog, or a cat walks by. Which one of those four will they drink from?
Water.
Depends on what they've been trained.
Okay.
The rat will drink Coca-Cola if it's been trained to drink it.
Okay.
Sorry to tell you.
But normally an animal from instinct would know that it ought to drink water rather than some alcohol or coffee. They smell it and they wouldn't drink it. And in that sense, those animals are wiser than us, wiser than people. What are people today doing drinking coffee and Coca-Cola and alcohol and then turn around and get all these diseases? Now, I want to just share with you, this is how I started speaking in China and in Korea and other places also about health. Because we all know that, remember, what does the Bible say? I will help you, I will strengthen you, yea, I will uphold you with what? The right hand of my righteousness. And not only does God uphold us with the right hand of his righteousness, but the health message is the right hand, the right arm, and the entering wedge into people's hearts these days. I'm going to just tell you about China. Just a few months ago, I started, I think it was on a Tuesday night, and on the beach in China, and giving health lectures and talking about health. And all for many hours in the evening, people would gather, hundreds, sometimes 50, 20, 80. Some people would come and go. And talking about health, about new start, nutrition, exercise, water. You know, in Chinese, they have a little saying, putting legs on a snake. A snake really doesn't need legs, right? They can get by okay without legs, but many times as Seventh-day Adventists, we try to put other things into the health message that God has already given us, which is the new start. We put in all these herbs and acupuncture and all these other things that are like putting legs on a snake. The snake doesn't really need the legs, and the nutritious food, exercise, water, sunshine, temperance, fresh air, rest. And, you know, Ellen White drank red clover tea.
Yes.
Sometimes. But we turn around and have a whole cabinet, a cabinet full of thousands of different herbs, hundreds of different herbs for this and that and this and that. And that's like putting legs on a snake. We don't really need that. Anyway, they're in China. I'll show you. Notice here, Christ's method alone will give what?
Jesus.
In reaching the people. The Savior mingled with men as one who desired their good. Then he showed him his sympathy, ministered to their needs, then won their confidence. Then he bade them follow me. Now, how do you make this thing go forward here now? Let's see if that's going to work. No? Forward. Okay. These are two brothers in Thailand that love the Father and the Son. And one of those brothers there, both of them live in Thailand, in Bangkok. One is from Belgium, one is from Germany. But the one from Germany here, he knows the Chinese church in Bangkok. So they invited me to come and speak there at that church. I was speaking in Chinese and then translating into Thai for the people there at that church. And we were talking about health in the afternoon. And then for about 3 hours, then someone brought up, we talked about health. And like it says, Jesus ministered to their needs, won their confidence, and today everybody is interested in health. So in the afternoon, one sister said, what about the Trinity? And that just opened up the door. And then this was from about 2 in the afternoon till 5 in the evening, and it was time at the church for dinner. They made the announcement, it's time to eat for the supper. But all these people, they didn't want to eat because they were so interested to hear about that the Trinity is a cunningly devised fable, and that the Bible says this is life eternal, to know thee, the only true God. Amen. And so it was exciting to see these people give up their dinner to listen more about the truth about God. Now, where I've been in China is on this island called Hainan Island. You can see all of China here. This is a pretty big size island. You can see how big it is there. I've been right down here at the bottom at a city called Sanya. And Sister White tells us that God has his people scattered around that have not bowed to Baal. And like the stars of heaven that appear at night, these faithful ones will shine forth when darkness covers the earth and gross darkness the people. And notice here how it talks about the Catholic lands of Europe, South America, China, in India, and in the islands of the sea. But this island is an island of the sea, and it's also part of China. So it sort of gets a double blessing on that place. And the reason that this island is so also a nice place to do witnessing is because China is still a communist, socialist, so-called atheistic country, and they don't really allow evangelism. But on this island, they call it the Hawaii of Asia. And people from Russia come there and from all over the world. If you meet 10 people on the beach and ask them where they're from, this is the beach there. They're from 10 different parts of China or from all over the world, actually. And so it's a wide open place to evangelize. I made up some little tracks, printed them just at the store about health, and going along the beach and sharing them with people. And I met this lady and her son. She has a German husband. And her son were walking, and then she said, "Oh, I want to introduce you to my husband." So we walked down, and this was her husband here. And I had a book in English, was able to share with him, and then we were studying the Bible together and teaching them how to walk. About for exercise, I asked them, "What is the best exercise?" And people would say swimming. Then I told them, "Well, walking is good, but this man here was a professional, sort of an amateur professional camera taker, picture taker,
photographer,
yeah. And all of a sudden, while I was walking on the beach, all of a sudden he started taking pictures. And I thought, is he a secret policeman for the government or something? I didn't know what was going on. And then he just took picture after picture, and then he came up and said that he's an amateur photographer and he'd like to take pictures. So he followed me around a few days and took all these pictures in China there. But anyway, let me go back. On Tuesday night, I began on the beach to give these lectures, and then Wednesday night about health, about nutrition. I told them, now we have two pans. One has brown rice, and one has white rice. Then I asked them, if the cockroaches and the ants come, will they eat the brown rice or the white rice? And I don't know if it's really true, but I told them that they would eat the brown rice. I hope that they would. But I think animals know that there's more nutrition in brown rice than white rice. And then it was Thursday evening, and every night as we were talking on the beach, we could see the sunset. And
did you put the mic on?
Okay. Is that working there?
No, that's not the mic.
Put that in the
Okay, put that in the pocket and put
that in the back pocket, and this is what needs to be forwarded.
Okay.
Just to make sure we get good stuff.
And then clip that on in front of you.
Okay, so Thursday night as the sun was setting, I was telling them about health, and then I told them how that courage and hope and sympathy and faith and love promote health and prolong life. But worry and regret and remorse, these kind of things weaken our life forces and invite decay and death. And these people were beginning to realize that whoever this guy is, he seems to know what he's talking about, health, and it made sense and it was logical. And so then when we switched into talking about spiritual things, they sort of reasoned, and this is what the spirit of prophecy tells us also, that if people seem to make sense about physical health issues, then they maybe would know what they're talking about spiritual things. Whereas if we would just begin in the very beginning and say, repent, the kingdom of heaven is at hand, and the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all sin. Many of them don't even know who Jesus is or anything about the plan of salvation. While those things are true, but the health message opens their heart. So Thursday night at sunset, I told them, now is the beginning of the preparation day. They had no idea in the world what a preparation day was. And I said, every day begins not at midnight, but at sunset. And tonight is the beginning of the preparation day, and then tomorrow at sunset, will be the beginning of the Sabbath, the seventh-day Sabbath of God. And night after night, two, three nights in a row, they were listening about health. And then on Friday night, I said, now we're welcoming the Sabbath. And if some of you would like to go with me to church tomorrow, we're going to meet at 8 o'clock in front of Feng Huang Dao. It was just a place down the road because we had to walk to the church. I said, if you'd like to come there at 8 o'clock in the morning, Feng Huang Dao Mianchen, we'll meet there. And seven total strangers I never met before, they came to church. Sabbath morning, they met there. Three couples, husband and wife, three couples, and another young man. And we walked 30 minutes through the town to the little church, walked up the stairs. They went through the whole service together. And the next week, that other single man came back, the others, because people come there from all over China. Some of them had already left. But I thought it was an amazing testimony to the power of the health message. We know that our life is in our blood, and that that the health message, Jesus spent more time doing what? Healing than he did preaching. And so last year we had a little baptism, and we found a little park in China, and these people were curious what in the world was happening at a baptism. Chinese had never seen a baptism before, and people going down in the water and up and down and stuff. And we found a nice little waterfall place, and about five sisters were baptized there, another brother too. It was in a nice place with these lily pads, and but that was a few months ago. Just last week, I want to just tell you real briefly about another means of outreach that's very easy for all of us to do, and that is telephone evangelism. Now, in Korea, where we live, whether you have a hand phone, a cell phone, or a home phone, every call you make, if you call from here over to Pastor Allen's house over there, you have to pay money for it. But here in America, aren't local calls free?
Yes.
And also on many of your cell phones, don't you have a package deal where you can call for a certain amount per month? You can call anywhere as much as you want, right?
Actually, mainland phones too.
Okay, mainland phones too. So what an opportunity to make use of the telephone to do telephone evangelism. Now, just last Friday in Chino Valley, Arizona, I was at my sister's house. Before I came, she took a piece out of the newspaper that listed all the local churches and their phone numbers. So I had a little prayer. Before you begin the telephone evangelism, we have a prayer. Ask God to guide and lead and bless and lead by His Spirit. And then I'd say to the folks, I was calling a lot of churches, pastors. I was calling, I think, on a Thursday or Friday, so that most of them were not at home, so you get a tape recorder. At the end of the beep, leave your message, please. So then you have 2 or 3 minutes to give a little sermon to them, or take your survey, or do whatever you did. What I did, the Lord will lead you, but what I did is to say, hello, ma'am, hello, sir. We are taking a community improvement spiritual health survey, and would like to just ask you one question. And then these were pastors and stuff, and pastors and elders at churches. So I said, based on the Bible verse that says, here is the patience of the saints. Here are those that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. In your opinion, ma'am, or in your opinion, sir, which one of the Ten Commandments do you think is the most neglected these days? So I asked them that question, and they'd answer back, or they'd call back. And the next day, I went to church in Chino Valley, and when I came back, my sister said, you got a phone call. It was from the Rabbi Adele. It was a female rabbi at the Jewish church. And I had said to her, I said, I want to learn about the Shabbat. And then I told her, Shalom Shabbat. Later on, she told me, no, you have to say Shabbat Shalom. The adjective goes at the end. It's Shabbat Shalom. But she called me back, and then I asked her about, well, tell me how you keep the Sabbath. And you know, they have a very nice method of keeping the Sabbath. They keep the Sabbath 25 hours instead of 26. They go until they can see three stars at night. If it's cloudy, then they still sort of just go an hour. But anyway, she said, I have a calendar, that a Jewish calendar that tells about this. And I said, well, should I come to your place or you want to come over? And she came over. She drove about 7 miles one way, 14 miles round trip, came out of her way, came over to my sister's house with this calendar. And she gave me this calendar, so I wanted to give her something. But I knew in our conversation, she thinks that Jesus was just a Jewish rabbi. And I said, well, what about Isaiah 53? You know where it says, who has believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? And he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of dry ground. He has no form nor comeliness. And when we should see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. And he was wounded for our transgressions, and he was bruised for our iniquities. And she said, oh yes, Isaiah was a very political prophet. And that was just a bunch of political nonsense and everything. And so she didn't even believe that Jesus was the Redeemer, or they still believe in a new Messiah. Now, when she said that, I could have put up both fists and began to fight, as it were, with her and try to convince her that she's wrong and that I'm right. But, you know, that wouldn't work. She was in the home. So I left her a tract that I got from the Chino Valley Church about what do lemons do, or something about lemons, that little yellow one, you reckon? The value of a lemon or something. And then another one about tobacco, because she asked me before she came, she said, does anyone smoke at your home? I said, no, because she's very allergic to tobacco. Anyway, to make a long story short, she came, and I was able to leave her these health books, and then at the end I gave her Patriarchs and Prophets, because I'd heard before that a Jewish rabbi read that book, and more than any other of the Spirit of Prophecy books, that book seemed to flow along the lines of Hebrew parallelism and the way Hebrews think and stuff. And she took that book and read it, and all of that nice conversation and outreach and leaving a book with her started just through a simple telephone call. And the telephone ministry you can do right in your own home at your leisure time. And some people, you know, will get upset and you woke me up and don't ever call again type thing. But you know, that's the same. They spit in Jesus' face. And they called him a drunkard or whatever. So anyway, I want to just encourage all of you in the health message that it really is an entering wedge and a right arm to open many people's hearts to understand the truth. Whereas if we were to come in the beginning just from a spiritual angle, many people wouldn't be interested. But in the area of health, that's why Jesus healed the lepers and raised the dead and spent so much more time healing than he did preaching. Why don't we just have a little prayer together, okay? Father in heaven, many years ago when Solomon prayed, knelt down and spread his hands toward heaven and ended his prayer, fire came down from heaven and consumed the burnt offering and the sacrifices, and the glory of the Lord filled the temple. Father, at our camp meeting this year that's just beginning here, we pray that you will send the fire of your Spirit upon us. And I pray that you'll bless Yao Shang Dong and Huang Hua Feng and Chen Jianhua there in China, and all of your people in China and Korea and Thailand and every nation, kindred, tongue, and people, especially here in America. Lord, give us wisdom how to reach out, how to share the everlasting gospel and the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus with those we come in contact. Thank you that you said you will uphold us with the right hand of your righteousness. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Again? Good evening. When we got here, I was surprised to find my name in the schedule for this, and I'm asking Sister Raquel, I'm like, what is this? What am I supposed to do? So I still don't know what I'm supposed to do, but I'm just going to do something. If it's all right with everybody, I would like to pray before we begin. Yes. Father, I thank you again for this opportunity, to come before you as a group. And Lord, I pray that you will send your Spirit to be here to fill each and every one of us. And Lord, I pray that as I talk about testimony and as I give our testimony a little bit, I pray that your Spirit will shine forth from me. And I pray that this will affect someone's life, that they will be drawn closer to you through this testimony. And this I ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
You know, many of us want to do something for the Lord. I can tell you that when I'd come to the Lord, when I felt my heartstrings starting to be drawn to the Lord, I wanted to do something. But, you know, those who really know me realize how painfully shy I am. So, you know, what is somebody who's this shy going to do? I mean, when I was a kid, somebody would say hi, I would hide behind my mother's skirt and cry. You know, that's how shy I have always been, and really still am. And so, you know, I didn't know what to do. I didn't know how to reach anybody, how to tell anybody. You know, also, quite honestly, growing up with red hair, very quick to be rejected, you know, in school. And so I hated rejection. So I didn't like the possibility of being rejected by telling somebody about Christ. And I was not sure what to do. I wanted to, desperately, but I didn't know how to go forward. I didn't know how to go about it. But, you know, and I know I'm not the only one. I'm not the only one with these thoughts. And so I want to share a couple of things from the Scripture first before I go into a testimony. Because, you know, there is something powerful about a testimony. You know, I can take this word here and I can go through this and I can corner almost anybody there is on the Sabbath. I can answer almost any question. You know, I've read all kinds of deep theological books from Sunday keepers, going into the Greek and the Hebrew, and it doesn't take much to destroy it. But what good does that do? You know, sooner or later, somebody can still take a text and they can twist it out of context. They can still make an argument against what you're trying to say. And there's a time and a place for presenting those things, for sure. But what I have found is that nobody can argue your testimony. They can argue your theology, but they cannot argue your testimony. They cannot say, that didn't happen to you. That did not affect you like that. Hey, I've never had anybody try, but I suppose somebody could try to make the argument, but there is something powerful with a testimony. And, you know, if we look in John chapter 2 and verse 25, or sorry, John chapter 1, and verses 29 to 34, but I don't have time to go through all of that. But what we see here is John gives a testimony. John the Baptist. He gives a testimony. And verse 34 is the summation of this testimony from John the Baptist. And he says there, "And I saw and bear record that this is the Son of God." Was this a deep theological dissertation that he gave? No. It was something very simple and very much to the point. It was not a doctoral dissertation. We don't have to be educated to give a testimony like this. But if you notice, what you do have to have is an experience with Christ. You have to have that experience first to be able to give the testimony. And John goes through the experience that he saw. Verse 32, and John bare record, saying, "I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it abode upon him. And I knew him not, but he that sent me to baptize with water, the same said unto me, upon whom thou shalt see the Spirit descending and remaining on him, the same is he which baptizes with the Holy Ghost." So John here is relating an experience that he had. that's the simplicity of what John did. It was nothing deep. It was nothing theological. It was a simple testimony. And what was the result of John's testimony? It was powerful, wasn't it? Didn't it move the world? You know, right after this is the first disciples. These disciples heard John's testimony and followed Christ. Yes, they were John's disciples and they became Christ's disciples based upon John's testimony. And so when we give a testimony, we also potentially can make disciples for Christ by pointing them to Him. And I won't go into it, but John chapter 4, the woman at the well. You know, she had an experience with Christ. We see that at the well. Something happened. She connected with Christ at that well. And what did she do? She dropped her water pot. And she went into the city and she told everybody, is not this, look, this is a man that has told me everything that I have done. Is not this the Christ? And what you find is that many of these people came to Christ and they came and heard Him speak. And then they said, you know, now we believe not because of what you said, but because we have heard Him ourselves. And so that is what we are to do with the testimony. We're to have an example, we're to have an experience with Christ, and then we tell others about that experience, that's our testimony, and in hopes that they will then connect with Christ and believe, not because of what we've said now, but because they also have had an experience. The demoniacs are another good example. Initially, the Gadarenes, they wanted Christ to leave, did they not? They didn't want Him to be around. They were afraid of Him. And these two demoniacs, they fell at Jesus' feet and said, Lord, we want to go with You. In other words, we want to learn from You. We want to sit at Your feet. We want to be Your disciples. But Christ said no. He said, go back to your town and tell them all the wonderful things that God has done for you. And the very next time Jesus came back to that area, the amazing thing is that news spread like wildfire that Christ was there, and people came from all over the place, and they brought their sick to Him. So when He was there the first time, they wanted nothing to do with Him. But when He came back, something happened. And the reason is because those demoniacs gave their testimony. They hadn't been with Christ. They didn't have any kind of training. And you don't have to have training to do this. They didn't have training. They weren't theologians. They simply gave a testimony. And they brought many people to Christ as a result of giving their testimony. And so it's that simple. You know, it doesn't have to be a deep... You don't have to know this inside and out. You don't have to have it memorized. You don't have to be able to go from verse to verse. When somebody asks you a question, it's okay to say, you know, that's a good question, I don't know. Because if you have all the answers every time, they're going to think you're a know-it-all. Honestly. You know, it's okay. And if you do have the answers every time, every once in a while say, you know, that's a good question. Let me look it up. Because nobody likes a know-it-all. So there are times to say that. And it's a good thing. So don't feel that you have to know everything in the Bible to be able to give a testimony. And so I want to go into kind of our testimony. And this isn't just my testimony. This is our testimony. Because, you know, I praise the Lord, we went through this together, my wife and I. This wasn't where it was one versus the other. We went through it together. But we used to have a car lot. And yes, I was a used car salesman. I didn't do very good at it because I'm not a salesman. And unfortunately, people wanted you to lie to them about the vehicles. I actually ran into that. But we ended up filing bankruptcy. This was during the Iraq War. Things went under very quickly when the war hit. And you know, here I am, I'm seventh generation Adventist. We can trace roots, according to my father, all the way back to the Advent movement. And I honestly, I grew up with the mentality, I'm an Adventist. You know that mentality? I was born and raised Seventh-day Adventist. I'm better than you all. You know, I'm saved because of my roots. Does that sound like the Jews? Because of who I am? But yet, I was so far from that, it wasn't even funny. You know, there's no point in getting into all of what I did and glorifying it, because there's no glory in it. But it wasn't good. It wasn't as bad as some other people. But we had our car lots, and we ended up filing bankruptcy. And here I am. When you're at the bottom, you've got no place to look but up. And the Lord had put a pastor in my path that had something that I wanted, and it just so happened, and I don't think it was by chance, that this pastor was there during this time, about my age. We connected very well, and that started to change things for me. And I remember one day, I still wasn't reading the Bible. In fact, I had the mentality that, and I remember telling my wife this, we were arguing about this when, not long after we got married. I said, "You don't need this." That's what I said. You don't need the Bible. You don't need anything in it. All you have to do is to be led by the Spirit. That's what I thought. But I remember one time my brother and I were working and we got into an argument about the Sabbath. He was raised Adventist as well, obviously. But we got into an argument over it. He was saying, you know, there's nothing wrong with going to church on Sunday. And I was saying, no, you can't do that. You have to be Sabbath. And but I couldn't prove it. I didn't know anything in here. I knew that it was provable because I'd heard the pastor prove it. But I couldn't do it. And so, you know, I sat down and I started reading a Bible. I didn't even know where to begin. I started reading in Matthew and looking for these proof texts for the Sabbath. And I ran into the verse. I was reading to prove him wrong. I was trying to find these verses. And I ran into the text that said, "Take the beam out of your own eye before you take the sliver out of your brother's eye." And I remember reading that and thinking, wow, how literal that is for me. Because here I am, I'm trying to take a sliver out of my brother's eye, and I've got a beam in my eye, and I can't even see his sliver because of the beam. That's how big it was. And that's when things really started to change for me. Fast forward some to where I started the testimony. A lot had changed for me, and I had started to have a peace that surpassed all understanding. And I wanted others to have this, but I don't know how to tell people. I was painfully shy, and so I decided I was going to go to Amazing Facts. And there's a whole line of miracles there that are just amazing. But I went to Amazing Facts, and then I found out you had to go door to door. Had I known that, I wouldn't have gone. I would not have gone. That first time going door to door, I remember my outreach partner, he was driving because I don't think I could function to drive. I was so paranoid and scared. But, I mean, I was slumped over in the seat. I felt like I had a 100-pound backpack on. I could barely get up. But things changed, and by the end of that afternoon, we had to meet up with the rest of the team. And my outreach partner said, "Oh, you know what? It's time to go." And I said, "No, we got three more houses. Let's get three more houses on this row, and then let's go." So, you know, it's something amazing happened there. Something changed. When I started going door to door, I found people that were interested. And that made it all worth it. And you know, believe it or not, nobody ever slammed the door on me. Amen. Nobody ever argued with me. People are actually fairly polite. You know, most people will say, "You know, I'm really not interested." You say, "Okay, thank you for your time, sir." And you go on to the next door. You're not looking for that person. You're looking for the person that's ripe. You're looking for the person that's ready. You're not looking for that one. And don't feel they're rejecting you. They're not rejecting you. They're rejecting Christ. Let it roll off your back. It's not anything against you personally. You just keep going. I entered the pastoral program. I don't know what I was thinking, because that means you got to stand up front. And the first time I had to speak in front of the church, and this is Sacramento. You know, it wasn't Sac Central, but it's still a big church. And I had butterflies in my stomach for a week prior. And the couple of days just before, I actually had the shakes really bad. I was that scared. And I remember saying, "Lord, what have you gotten me into?" And you know, I would have said no. I just can't do this, but I knew I was called. I knew I was called to do it. And so I did it. I can still very clearly, very vividly remember that first sermon. And I'm up there, I'm sitting in the elder's chair, you know, just I think I was probably visibly shaking at that point. It was terrible. That's how bad I was sweating. And when it was time for me to get up, I didn't know what to do, so I knelt and prayed. And you know, I stood up, and within probably 10 seconds, something happened. And I can't tell you I know what it was, but I can't describe it other than just this peace came over me. The shaking stopped. There was no longer a crowd of people. There was just a bunch of individuals. Something happened, and all the fear went away, just like that. And I was able to speak, and I was able to actually engage individuals in the audience. You know, and from there, a lot has happened. Many miracles, many different things have happened. You know, I just want to give this one brief. Before we went to Amazing Facts, we laid all on the altar. I heard very clearly, there's very few times that I've heard clearly something from God. And this was very, very clear to go. And we said, "Okay, Lord, we don't have the money." I was an electrician. I did not make much money. We didn't have enough money to save up to go. And it wasn't possible. And Christy said, "Well, we will basically name it and claim it. God told us to go, so we believe He's going to provide the way." And we put all that we had on the altar. We had everything up for sale. And you know, I was so frustrated. Within a week of before we had to go, nothing sold. I was like, "Lord, how are we going to have the money to go? I'm doing all that I can. You told me to go. You have to provide the way. You have to sell these things." But you know what happened? Money literally appeared. It's not like somebody sent a check and I cashed a check. It's not like we had bad accounting. I couldn't possibly have made that money in that short of time. It wasn't possible. But yet money literally appeared. Mysteriously, it was there. And it's not financially accountable. It was a direct miracle, and that's the only possible way it could happen, was a direct miracle. So, you know, we have been commissioned to go. Amen? We've all been commissioned to go. It's not the leaders that were commissioned to go. It's not those disciples that were commissioned to go. It's each and every one of us that's been commissioned to go. And it doesn't all have to be up front. It doesn't all have to be knocking on doors. But it has to be going. And you know, God has told us to go, and He will make that way available. We just have to have the faith. We just have to say, "You know what, Lord? I will go." You just stop focusing on what you see and just start stepping forward. Just start walking forward. And the doors will open. It might be a challenge. It might build your faith. You might be living hand to mouth for a little while. Maybe the whole time. You know, I don't know. But all it takes is go. And there's really nothing more powerful than giving a testimony. It's simple. It doesn't take a lot of theological knowledge. You don't have to have 101 verses memorized. You don't have to be able to walk somebody through the 2300 days off the top of your head. You don't have to do that. And it's something that can't be refuted. That's really all there is to it. You tell them what happened in your life because of this, because of that. And you know, it will affect people. You might not see it. And don't get discouraged. Not everybody is called to reap, but everybody is called to sow the seeds.
Amen.
So if you're not reaping a harvest with somebody right off the bat, don't go try and cramming this down their throats. It's not going to do any good. Just keep planting the seed and allow the Holy Spirit to water.
Amen.
You know, when we try to take on the job of the Holy Spirit, that is blasphemy. It is the Holy Spirit's job to convict, not ours. It's not my job to convict anybody. It's simply my job to bring the message and leave the rest to God. But again, you know, a good way to do that is a simple, clear, concise testimony. Everybody here would claim to be a Christian. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Do you know you have a testimony? And if you don't have one every day, pray for one every day. And he'll give you a testimony every day. Even if it's something incredibly simple. You might think it's simple, but the person beside you that you're witnessing to might strike them as very profound. You never know. Don't worry about the results. Just plant the seed. Let God water.
Amen.
With that, I'd like to end with a word of prayer. Father, I thank you for the testimony that you have given each and every one of us. I thank you that you have touched our hearts. And I also thank you more than that. I thank you that we have the opportunity to give that testimony to someone else, that it may touch their hearts. And Father, I pray for your blessings. I pray if we don't have a testimony each and every day, that you will give us a testimony. And Lord, more importantly, I pray that you will give each and every one of us a divine appointment. I pray that you will bring somebody across our path that is needing an uplifting word, that is needing whatever it is that you want us to give them. And Lord, I know that you do this because you've done it so many times for me. And I just pray that you will give each and every one of us a testimony of giving a testimony. That you will give each and every one of us an example, an experience of giving a testimony. And Lord, I thank you for giving us the opportunity to work with you, to be your vessels. And I ask that you will fill us so fully with your Spirit that people don't see us, but they see Christ in us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Session where we can get, you know, share our testimonies with to encourage one another. And I have requested to share with each one of you a report of the work that's going on in Philippines. I'm sure many of you know David Sims. He's been in the Philippines with Morgan Polsky and another brother, Chris Sparks, and working together with Restitution Ministries to try to establish a school of the prophets in the Philippines. And so I thought that you might be interested to see some of the pictures and see how their journey is going there. They've met many trials and I'm sure disappointments, but their desire is to want to get a school established for the many young people that are there that believe like we do. So the truth about God message is really spreading very quickly in that island. Yes. So I'll begin with a report that they sent for all of you. I'll begin reading and then I'll share some pictures and some quotes that I have. Waldensian Center's Wilderness Sojourn. The Lord opened up the way for a medical missionary training school to get set up in the northern part of the Philippines earlier this year. More than a dozen students from different parts of the country attended the school. We conducted work education classes in the morning and the formal studies in the afternoon. We would do agriculture, electrical, welding, and some other practical skills like hammock making for their work education. We also learned to make some health products and to operate some tools like planers, drill press, drills, saws, etc. Some of the students also had the chance to assist, thank you, sweetie, to assist firsthand in the sanitarium associated with the school operated by the local brethren. The Lord was truly blessing the school, and the students were learning the major doctrines as well as other necessary principles. The routine continued for a couple of months until the Lord opened the way for a different learning experience. We quickly outgrew our location and required a place where we could put up the industries and serve agricultural purposes as well, so the school could be self-supporting. We started to scout some properties nearby, but while Brother Stefan or Brother Fred, who I don't think is with us right at this moment, and Brother Morgan were in Cebu visiting some brethren, the Lord directed them to a 5-hectare property that the owners wanted to give to the Lord, and it was offered to us for only 25,000. I'm not sure what the currency there in the Philippines, what it's called, but 25,000 Philippine dollars. They visited the property and found it had coconut trees, bananas, pineapples, and some other crops. It also had a spring on it and a waterfall. It seemed like it was exactly what we needed, so we believe that Providence was leading us south to the central portion of Philippines. We packed up and headed to the island of Negros, which is in the group of islands known as Visayas. The move was quite abrupt, and even though we had something prepared beforehand, our future was still uncertain. We knew that there was a property, but there were no facilities there yet. This required faith, courage, and boldness. So, like Gideon, we announced, "Whosoever is fearful and afraid, let him return and depart early." Judges 7, verse 3. Half of the students remained, while the other half joined the company on the journey. It was only a few days before the Holy Week when we began to head down, and so it was a real challenge to get the transportation lined up. But we clearly saw how the Lord provided exactly what we needed, just when we needed it. When possible, we would plan ahead and do everything we could to get things lined up. But at times, when we had reached the limit of human possibilities, the Lord would take us in His hands. Heading south. We drove our way south, transferring from one ferry to another, hopping from island to island. The first night we spent on the road, driving. The next day, while on the ferry, some of the students sang hymns which caught the attention of another passenger. The stranger approached us and we found out that she was an Adventist. She offered for us to stay in their school that night. When we arrived at our destination, within a couple of days, circumstances turned out different than what we expected. It became clear that the owners of the land had a change of heart and decided what they really wanted was a temporary caretaker for their property and adjacent properties. They told us that they would not sell it for any price or even lease it. So we began our search for another place. The search. We were strangers in the land and did not have a place to stay, but on our first Sabbath, our connection there invited us to stay in their place. We spent the next week driving around the island looking for a place, and the Lord would always open a door for us where we could spend the night. Complete strangers would open their homes for us, and we saw how the pillar of cloud and the pillar of fire led us all throughout the journey. We were also led to different Seventh-day Adventist churches and schools on the island and met different people along the way. In one instance, we stopped at some concrete spot by the roadside and ate our lunch. While eating, we noticed that it was actually a driveway of an Adventist school. Later on, some school staff passed by and approached us. After learning that we were missionaries from the northern part of the Philippines looking for a place in their island, they invited us to stay for the night. It was late in the afternoon already, and we still had to find a place to spend the night, but the Lord knew what we needed and provided it just when we needed it. Our faith and patience was tested every time. Every single experience was a learning experience. Sometimes some would complain and murmur about the inconveniences, but others would bring sunshine and joyful songs in the air. Things could be really bitter sometimes, but each experience taught us lessons that sweetened the character. After nearly traversing the entire island and making many friends and contacts, we found a place we could rent temporarily. It was a beach house, and it would serve our needs for the moment. How we found it revealed God's providence as well, since it cost only about a tenth of the regular houses for rent that we had checked. We have continued to look for a property and have checked all possible connections that we have. So far, none of the properties we have seen are ideal for our purposes. While searching for properties, we conducted some classes when we could and sought to instruct our students in everyday life situations. The students, though seeing how God has led us throughout the way, like Israel of old, some would complain. We also saw the enemy seeking to destroy the work by bringing negative emotions within our midst. We even had to send a student home because it was the best thing and the only thing left that would reach and help her and everyone else. Part of our team went to the island of Mindanao and saw the Lord open up numerous doors for reaching souls with the truth about God. From time to time, we have had the opportunity to use our medical missionary skills taught at the school by ministering to the physical needs of various people. One of these cases was a youth of one of our neighbors. As we ministered and sang and prayed, the heart of the mother was touched, and she became interested in attending our worships. She has been learning many things, and one day she asked about the mark of the beast. As we shared about the beast's mark and the seal of God, she accepted the Sabbath, and she worshiped with us that Sabbath. She plans to continue to worship with us. She is anxious to learn vegetarian cooking and all she can about every subject. This has been a great encouragement to us and reminds us that God has a reason for all of his providences, and we should never doubt when we have seen evidence of his leading. Now we know why the Lord has led us to spend this time in this particular location. We have recently decided to send the remaining students home, and if the Lord wills, start a new session at some time in the future when we have a proper place and some more staff. Though the regular formal training during the wilderness sojourn part of our term has been limited, We have all learned many things that will prepare us for heaven and for service in this world. This training has been more in line with Israel's industrial school in the wilderness, education page 37, John the Baptist's wilderness school, Desire of Ages page 102, David's wilderness school of hardship and sorrow, education page 152, and Moses' wilderness school of poverty, SW, I'm not sure what that stands for, if anybody knows.
What's that?
SW, which?
Southern Watchman.
Southern Watchman, page 23, thank you. Please continue to pray for the great lack of trained gospel workers in the Philippines and the world field to fill the many Macedonian calls for help. In the service of Christ, David Sims. So that is the end of that letter slash report to all of you from Pastor David. Regarding the schoolwork, they're still looking for property and they're going to be taking a break from the actual classes to, he's going to have to do some traveling, but there really is a need for schools. And I'll show you pictures here. Before I was going to show you pictures, I just wanted to share a few quotes on education to inspire you with the importance of this work. This is from the book Education by Ellen White. It says, true education does not ignore the value of scientific knowledge or literary acquirements. But above information, it values power. Above power, goodness. Above intellectual acquirements, character. The world does not so much need men of great intellect as of noble character. It needs men in whom ability is controlled by steadfast principle. Wisdom is the principal thing, therefore get wisdom. The tongue of the wise useth knowledge aright. Proverbs 4, verses 7 and chapter 15, verse 2. True education imparts this wisdom. It teaches the best use, not only of one, but of all our powers and acquirements. Thus, it covers the whole circle of obligation to ourselves, to the world, and to God. Character building is the most important work ever entrusted to human beings. And never before was its diligent study so important as now. Never was any previous generation called to meet issues so momentous. Never before were young men and young women confronted by perils so great as confront them today. At such a time as this, what is the trend of the education given? To what motive is appeal most often made? To self-seeking. Much of the education given is a perversion of the name. In true education, the selfish ambition, the greed for power, the disregard for the rights of needs and of humanity that are the curse of our world find a counter-influence. God's plan of life has a place for every human being. Each is to improve his talents to the utmost and faithfulness in doing this. Be the gifts few or many entitles one to honor. In God's plan, there is no place for selfish rivalry. Those who measure themselves by themselves and compare themselves among themselves are not wise. Whatever we do is to be done as of the ability which God giveth. It is to be done heartily as to the Lord and not unto men, knowing that of the Lord ye shall receive the reward of the inheritance, for ye serve the Lord Christ. Colossians 3:23 and verse 24. Precious the service done and the education gained in carrying out these principles. But how widely different is much of the education now given. From the child's earliest years, it is an appeal to emulation and rivalry. It fosters selfishness, the root of all evil. We need schools in this country to educate children and youth that they may be masters of labor and not slaves of labor. Ignorance and idleness will not elevate one member of the human family. Ignorance will not lighten the lot of the hard toiler. Let the worker see what advantage he may gain in the humblest occupation by using the ability of God, the ability God has given him as an endowment. Thus he can become an educator, teaching others the art of doing work intelligently. He may understand what it means to love God with the heart, the soul, the mind, and the strength. The physical powers are to be brought into service from love to God. The Lord wants the physical strength, and you can reveal your love for Him by the right use of your physical powers, doing the very work which needs to be done. There is no respect of persons with God. From many places, calls are coming for ministers, for teachers, for physicians to carry on the work in sanitariums, but we have not the trained workers to send. We have sanitariums, but we need more of these institutions in various places. We need schools that will be self-supporting, and this can be if teachers and students will be helpful, industrious, and economical. There is no need for debts to accumulate on our schools, and the old debts should be cleared away. Sacrifices must be made on every hand. We must devise and plan and labor to the utmost to be thrifty and economical. In the common school, some things are taught that are a hindrance rather than a blessing. We need schools where the Word of God is made the basis of education. The Madison Training School for Teachers should have the hearty support of God's people. Therefore, I ask you and your associates on the conference committee to act liberally in helping our brethren in Madison in this important work. I'm not sure how many of you know the story of Madison, but it's a good history for all of us to know. And she fully supported the schoolwork because it's so important for us to take care of our youth, to make sure that they're grounded in the truth, and to also have the church, to be able to have workers for the church that will be men of strong character, noble character, as she says. Okay, so I will now share some pictures. Ashley, you're going to have to point the camera to them. I think that's as big as I can get on my screen. Can you double click? It doesn't work that way. Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, that's about as big as you can make it. And I may have to just use my laptop. Okay, here's a picture of a baptism. I don't know all the details, and if Brother Fred were here, he might be able to give you more details, because he was in the Philippines for a lot of this, what was going on then earlier this year. This is the house that they rented by the beach when they're looking for property. And this is here, chop saw, it says here. All of the pictures that you will see, majority of them is in Ilocos, Philippines. They were having classes in a sanitarium as well. Here's one of the classes. There's Brother Morgan, Brother Chris, Brother Fred here is on the background, and Pastor David, and some of the students here. agricultural work, clearing the field for garden. And I think they were planting eggplant. And these little covers here is to keep them from wilting. Here's a picture of one of their meals. Once again, here's a picture of their plants with some shade, because the sun can be very oppressive. Here's Brother Morgan teaching English. This is the hammock making class. And irrigation, this is, they were doing some irrigation work here. Here's a picture by the beach. This is while they were traveling from Ilocos to Negros. Another picture of the students here walking through a trail. Medical missionary training. They were doing some planing here. They were going to make some beds. They didn't have any beds, and a lot of the students were sleeping on the floor, so they were working on making their own beds. Here's another picture of the garden. And another picture of the students. There's Brother Fred, Brother Morgan, Brother Chris, and Pastor David. I wish I knew all the names of everybody, but I don't. Here's another picture. And this is the sanitarium that is still being worked on there, where they had classes. They were planting their seeds, I guess, there. This is the staff of the school. Some welding classes and evening worship. And I think that's the last one. Well, if you have any questions about the school or, you know, any other thoughts, you can ask me or my husband. And anyway, we do appreciate your prayers for this work. And thank you for listening. I think that's it.
Well, certainly I am thankful up till this moment. Now I don't really know what to say. I'd like to start with where we're from. We're old. That's obvious. Everybody knows how long we've lived. And things have certainly changed, and we haven't. It's hard to keep up. We started out, I've been an Adventist all my life, as my wife has, and we were brought up in the Adventist church and thought that was the remnant church, and I think we know it was once. And so I'm going to start with Bethel Academy, where we went when we in Wisconsin. Bethel Academy was what has become Wisconsin Academy, and I'm no student or a scholar of any kind, and so after I'd been there for 5 years, they dismissed me to get rid of me, I think. But I did learn something there. I had the maintenance boss. He was also a science teacher, and he taught chemistry and welding and mechanics, and he was an all-around man. He was my boss. He gave me the assignment to be the fireman, and I wasn't a really good Christian, and he knew it, but he loved me, and I knew he did. So Friday night when I went around firing the boilers, he came and did all my work for me, and I was his captive for the night. So he tried to tell me what I needed to do, and then afterwards he says, "Would you like to pray with me?" And I didn't, and so he prayed, but he didn't say or ask me to pray. But I respected that man. I found out how to keep the Sabbath when we had to clean the sewer on Sabbath. or fix, pull the pump, whatever, because that's always when it broke. We had company on the weekend, and these systems were overloaded. So, but he did. He would sing hymns and so on, and I didn't have to sing with him. I just worked with him, and we. So, he was a saint in my eyes, and then there was one. I'll just tell you one other thing: how things have changed. The Wisconsin Conference owned one truck, and that was Mr. Cole's charge. And it was my goal to be able to drive that truck. And the fifth year I was there, I had the privilege of driving that truck, and that was a responsibility, and I really felt grateful for it. And I was driving that truck. We used it to haul coal. We used it to haul the girls and the boys to recreation. That was our school bus. That was transportation. So we come back from hauling coal, scrubbed up the bus, or the truck, put the girls in it, we put a top on it, tarp, so they could stand up in there, and that was all right. And we had a chaperone, the girls' dorm, the dean. She rode with me in the cab, and that made it legal at that time. You can't do things like that now, but we did it then. Anyway, she also loved me, I guess, and she was trying to make me a better boy. And so she was talking to me, and we got to the gym where we're going to have recreation that night. I forgot all about the girls. I was trying to be respectful and listen to her. And I did remember where to turn to the gym, and I turned, and of course all the girls fell down, hit the side of the truck, and it raised the sideboards on the side. They went up, and I straightened it out. They came back down, bang like that, and then all the girls fell on the floor, and my wife was in with the girls. At any rate, I let the girls out the back, unlocked the door and let the girls out. They were mad as hornets, and I didn't have a friend in the bunch. So, but it was interesting, and school was different. Now Wisconsin Academy is a modern school. But I've never forgotten that. They kept me, I remember who the other teachers were, but these two, the girls' dean and Mr. Cole, were the ones that kept me in the church, so to speak. But I was, like I said, and then after all this time as Adventist, we came here 5 years ago, and I was rebaptized. I felt I needed to be, and Pastor Allen, Don Cox is the one that told him that. I was sharing with Don Cox, and he said, I said to him, I think it would be good to be rebaptized. He says, what about today? I said, well, I don't even know the pastor. He introduced me to Pastor Allen. Pastor Allen asked me questions, and then he asked me if my heart was strong enough because the water was going to be really cold. And at any rate, I was rebaptized. So I've been thankful for this group here. It's been a wonderful experience to be able to fellowship with people that believe the same, and we can share what we believe and the goodness of our Lord. And that, I guess, I abbreviated everything. I've lived a long time, so there's more to say, but I can't remember it. I'm going to stop. Thank you for listening.
Well, my testimony isn't about what I've done for God, because it's been so little, but what He has done for me, and that's been a lot. Amen. As a young child, I loved people, and I loved nature. And for people, it could be babies or grandmas and grandpas, it didn't matter. I just loved people. And I used to go visit a grandma lady that lived across the road and over from us. And she had kittens, and she also made home brew in a tub, and she had that in her room, and she offered me a drink of that, and my mom told me, don't you ever drink anything at her house, but I could play with the kittens. And that was a lot of fun for me, and I enjoyed her. And we always had people coming to our house that were elderly people, grandmas and grandpas. Grandpas mostly, I think. My mother used to do washing for them, and she hauled the water from the river and scrubbed on a scrub board. But eventually she got a washing machine, but she was a hard worker. And we, and I always enjoyed Grandpa Carpenter. He'd come and bring his washing, come and pick it up, and he was...
The ringer washer, the old-time ringer washers.
Well, we graduated to a ringer washer.
Okay.
It was a scrub board at first, and my grandpa had made a bench. We had two wash tubs that sat there, one for rinsing and one for washing. Anyway, I just always, like I said, enjoyed people. And then my aunt had a baby, and I adored that baby, and I wanted to play with it and pick it up and everything, and she was very protective of that baby. But a year or two later, she had another baby, and from then on, I was welcome to do anything I wanted to with my little cousins. And I did a lot of babysitting, and I did babysitting for other people too in the neighborhood, and I just always loved children and nature. And as a very young child, I played with bugs, and I remember a pretty flower we called it milkweed. I have never seen anything like it anywhere else but in Tomahawk where I lived. But it had dainty little pink flowers on it, and when you picked them, you got a milky substance on your fingers that didn't feel too good and was kind of sticky. But it had beautiful little bugs on it that were, they looked like a ladybug, only in size and the way they acted and everything, but they were iridescent. Now, I've never seen them anywhere else but there, and I loved to play with those little bugs, and I'd pretend they were little cars or something, and then the high chair, there were four of us in the family, and I was number three, and so there was no step on the high chair anymore, but there was a little hole where the step plugged in. And I used to pretend that was the garage, and I'd park my little bugs in that hole. And one day, my mother tells this, that I went to pick up one of those little bugs, and it opened up and was going to fly. And I hollered, "Mommy, Mommy, look quick, it opened its feathers and crawled on its knees." And that was the only story I remember from my childhood that my mother remembered, because she was hardworking and had four youngsters to bring up. My dad was there too, but he was 20 years older than my mother, and he was an alcoholic cigar maker, so my mom had kind of a hard row to hoe. He was not a mean man. He used to rock me to sleep at night, and he'd sing hymns and story songs, and if I needed to be spanked, I'd rather have my dad spank me than my mother, because he always very gently wrapped me around his knee and put the spanks where they belonged, where if Mom was going to spank me, I tried to escape. And I was a little the worse for wear for doing that. But she was a wonderful mother, and she loved the Lord, and we had worship every morning and every night while my dad was very respectful. If he was there, he'd kneel and listen. But and when he was in his 80s, and our daughter was baptized, my dad and my daughter were baptized together. So that was a precious experience. Now, I don't know, I have no watch on because my dear friend, I loaned it to. Where?
The clock. You see the clock up there?
You have about 2 minutes.
2 minutes, okay. Well, as I said, I always loved nature too, and I worked at a school in Minneapolis, And it was supposed to be childcare, kind of keep them from killing each other, you know. And I thought, how much nicer to have something that they enjoyed doing, and then they would think about that. And so I started a nature program, and I recorded from television nature things. And then I got coloring books that had nature things, and I did units, and I did creepy crawlies and birds and mammals, and did it that way. And I'd have them color their picture and keep it in a file, and when we had that unit done, then they, for an art project, they'd make the covers and put it together. The parents loved it, and I just did simple things like that. Took them for nature walks, and the kids began to not be a problem anymore. They were enjoying what they were doing, and it was childcare for morning and afternoon, kindergarten alternate, and then after school daycare till the parents came after them. But this program went over so big that they asked me if I would be willing to do it in for the other schools at another site. And it would cover all five schools in Minneapolis. And I said, well, I'd be glad to do it, but we only had one vehicle and my husband needed it for his job. And they said, well, if we'd transport you, would you be willing to do it? So I said, sure, I'd love to do it if I had a way to get there. And so they began to take me to the other site, and so I was able to do the program with all the children. And it's a nice way to teach them that there's a loving God that has a lot of ideas for making lovely things in nature.
Amen.
Most of my life has been involved in the work here in West Virginia, especially Wyoming County and the neighboring county, McDowell. And you know, we can do a great work, but we must never think, look what I did. Because our work is always on the top of someone else's work. It's like stair steps. So we're going to go back to the 1920s. Now, I can't go into all the details, but from what I understand, back in the 1920s, and trust me, that was before I was born, there were two brethren. One was a brother Belcher, and the other one a brother Misbal. And they were young men, and they were going from door to door selling books. This country.
Great Depression, right.
Then there was a family that just down the road. Those came in from Welch here, past the spot where they lived. And they were fresh out of Mount Vernon. They had graduated from Mount Vernon Academy. They had patience. And God blessed them. They would go. They knew somebody was sick. They would, like, if they had sore throat, they would do a cold compression on their throat. If problems, they would use an onion and bake that onion and wrap it up and put it on the ear. So they did an amazing work. And you know, if you reach out to people's physical needs, the chances are that you can reach out to their spiritual needs. And so in 1935, now they went to all the homes around here, and at that time it was heavily populated. But in 1935, well, even before 35, they started visiting my mother-in-law. She just lived up the hill. You see where the white house is beyond mine. There was another house in front of that, and that's where she raised her 8 children. And they came and visited her. And from time to time, children would need some, they picked up something in school and they would need help. And so therefore, they would come and help her. Then they started studying with her. And she accepted the message of the soon coming of Jesus and the Sabbath. And upon her, before she was actually baptized, she was baptized in 1935, But before she was baptized, she kept her first Sabbath. And she sent one of her children down the road, down the creek a little ways, with a bushel of string beans. And in the bushel of string beans, there was a note: "I kept my first Sabbath." And I cannot imagine the joy that it brought to the hearts of those who had been studying with her. And she was baptized in Indian Creek. And I was hoping that Kevin could have been baptized there, but I didn't think of it soon enough to cut the grass down to get there. But anyhow, they started meeting in people's homes. Now, this is good if you have to, but as the older folks needed more work, the work was getting bad around here, they had to move on to other places. And then the young people that had been had been taught this message, they were, they wanted to go off to academy. The parents wanted them in our academies, And so they lacked one thing, and that was the vision. To start building a church and building a school. Now, you might think, well, not everybody can do that, but trust me, God can do it. And so the work kind of died down. The people down here, which was my mother-in-law and my deceased husband and his family, they would drive 50 miles to church. In Princeton, this was every Sabbath. And after a time, Glenn, he moved away to South Carolina, and my mother-in-law was left as just by herself with no interaction with other Adventists. And so in 1971, my home was breaking up. And at that time, I was working at the General Conference. And of course, whatever goes on around that area, everybody knows about it, There's so many churches in that immediate area. And so I had a friend from Rhodesia then, it's now Zimbabwe. And I was tempted, they tried to encourage me to come out to Rhodesia because he was going out as a treasurer of one of the, I don't know if it was a conference or a union or what it was, but they were sure that I could work for him. So I talked to Melvin Adams. I don't know if any of you here know him, Elder Melvin Adams. And he said, well, with the ages of my children, he says, I would strongly suggest that you stay in the States at this time. And so my next choice was West Virginia. Now, you have to understand, in 1954, when I came through West Virginia for the first time, I said, I'll never live in West Virginia. Not only that, about in the 50s, I said, I will never become one of those people, Seventh-day Adventists. So don't say never. But anyhow, in 1971, they had a very bad flood at a place called Buffalo Creek. It was really bad.
A coal dam burst
and just took out the whole hollow. And so anyhow, I heard about it, and so I got busy, and I had a station wagon at that time, and I just went ahead and loaded that station wagon up with all the clothes, whatever I could get to take to bring down here. So that was my introduction to this area. And then after my home broke up, I moved down here in 1972. Now, this is just kind of a backdrop of what has transpired in all those years. And so at that time I met, I think, a very handsome man, and Glenn, and we got married. But believe it or not, a lot of our conversation during the courting season all pertained to God's work. He dearly loved the Lord, and I loved the Lord, and I loved him. And so anyhow, we started out as a team, and we were young. And I look at Christy and Andy and Thomas and Raquel, these young couples. It's so good seeing how you're taking hold. Because as older folks, you know, we need to pass the torch on. Amen. And so you have a vision. Stay with it. Because God will see you through. But anyhow, we immediately, in 72, started. We went to the Princeton Church. But we started a branch Sabbath school right down here in the hollow. And that went well for a time. And then by 19, that was in 72. In 1973, we were what they call a branch Sabbath school with 12 members. Small. And sometimes there were only two, my husband and me. But we always kept the doors open. Always. And then in 1974, we started meeting again back in my mother-in-law's home. And in 1975 of April, we had it set up to have Sabbath school and church. And we used several buildings over in Welch. And I said to Glenn, you know, we need to start a building fund. And not that I'm that crazy about building funds, because I've been a treasurer for 40-some years in different churches total. And I know how that can be. But anyhow, we had a little church at that time. And this is when we were at the organized church. And we had this little church, and we put money in there each Sabbath. And in 74, Glenn and I were in a very bad accident. A couple of people were killed. And,
an automobile accident.
Yes. A couple of people were killed, and my left ankle was broken, and his right knee was broken. But God saw us through it while we were there in the hospital. We had the friends that Oliver and Grace Harold that lived just down the creek here. They were still living. And they brought us bags of books. And so what we would do, we'd get in our wheelchair and we'd go from one room to the other. And a book that I dearly love is The Desire of Ages. And I would take that book. I had it in my lap at the time of the accident, too, and it was kind of bent. But anyhow, I would take that book with me in the wheelchair to the room, and I would visit with the people, and I said, oh, I want to share a little nugget with you. And so I would read a little from The Desire of Ages. And there was one girl, I don't know whatever happened to her, but she loved the book so much, and, oh, I'd love to have it. So I went ahead, before I left the hospital, I gave her that, my Desire of Ages. So this is some of the wonderful experiences that the Lord has led us into. And I don't care what kind of a problem we have, God can bring good out of it.
Right.
He can bring good out of it. So in April of 1975, we launched our first building program. And due to the accident that took place in 74, the man had the minimum insurance coverage, and so therefore, by time I had to pay lawyer's fees and hospital and doctor fees, there wasn't a whole lot left. But we had $5,000 that we put in the bank, and Glenn said, well, we'll keep that $5,000 so that if you need another surgery, we'll have it. Well, in 1978, I went out to California. And on the way back, God impressed me, really laid it on my heart. Why should I hold on to that $5,000 when it could be in the Lord's work? So when I got home, I talked to my husband about it. Let's put that in the Lord's work. In the meantime, God had a literature evangelist. They used to call them call porters, but now I think they all go by literature evangelists. And this literature evangelist went to the conference and said that, he says, I will give $5,000 towards work in southern West Virginia on the condition you can find someone who will match it. Oh, this was taking place in his life, what he wanted to do, and at the same time the Lord had worked with me about giving that $5,000. By that time,
was that Fred?
Yes, that was Brother Fred Seeley. I don't know if anyone here knows who he is or was. But anyhow, I can see in so many ways how the Lord has been leading. So in 1979, remember I told you about the little building fund? Well, in just a very short time, we had $3,000. And I had talked to the minister, conference minister, about maybe the church could help us out. And this minister, he said, you don't have any financial stability. This is Appalachia. And I said, well, no, we don't, but God does. And so in a short time, we were able to come up with $15,000. This is in 76. And so we only got started with the work, you know, in 72, 73, in those years. So by 76, we had raised $15,000. I'll tell you a little bit about how some of the people raised their money. One girl had poodles, and she's not even is not even an Adventist. But she said to me, I'm going to sell, when I sell one of my poodles, I'm going to give you the money, Wanda K. She said, I'm going to give you this, the money for it. And then another person, I'll never forget it. Her name was Angie. Angie was a sweet little girl. She really loved the Lord. And they were as poor can be. I thought I was poor. So anyhow, I went over her house one day, and it was very run down. And she says, Mom, she called me Mom, I got something to show you. And she was so excited. And I said, well, what is it, sweetheart? She came out, I don't know how many of you who are Adventists all your life wouldn't know probably, but she came out with a shot glass. Just a little shot glass, and she was putting quarters in that shot glass. And when it got full, she wanted to show it to me. So God works in marvelous ways. So anyhow, we went ahead, and in 1980, April the 2nd of 1980, we had our groundbreaking. And this was about 5 miles down the road. And Glenn and I, we started as soon as they broke ground. We started, he would work all day and come home. We'd work part of the night. And we could get temporary lights up. That was great because we could work longer.
Glenn was a contractor.
Glenn was a building contractor, so he was able to do pretty much whatever needed to be done. And then December the 3rd of 1983, the Indian Creek Church still had $800 owing on it. We asked the conference, you know, no. So they had what they called a 200 club. They lent us $3,000 and we paid them back as quickly as we could. So my husband, he was giving them the history, you know, and that we still owed 800, but the Lord would see us through that. Well, a lady in the congregation, she says, I'll cover that 800 right now. Aww. So you see how wonderful God is. And then after all of that, the conference comes out, the conference treasurer, I'm sorry, the conference involved here, comes out with a $1,000 check towards maybe a PA system. So anyhow, we eventually got a PA system in there. Now from 1983, well, I have to go back a little bit because when I was baptized in 1965, and the minister that baptized me was William Kaufman. I don't know if you ever heard of him. But anyhow, there's one comment that he gave me, and he says, I want you to study that sanctuary inside and out. So he was a godly man, and I started studying the sanctuary. And so it ended up, we had some speakers coming to our church. This was we were with the conference church. And this one minister, he gets up there and he says that Christ didn't have a drop of human blood in his body. I knew differently. Then we had a minister to come in and say that there was only a one apartment sanctuary. You need to study the sanctuary inside and out. The whole plan of salvation is in the sanctuary. So we started speaking out. And it got to the point, it was so bad, that the church was divided. And by this time, Pastor Allen was in the picture. And Glenn started sharing some things with Allen. And I think, I mean, with Allen started sharing some things with Glenn. And so it was decided that, you know, how could we continue there? First, we were told that we could not hold any offices. Well, okay, that took care of the elder, church clerk, I mean, you name it. The only one was left was the head deacon. Even the pianist couldn't play because she didn't go along with the conference. And so, believe me, I don't have any animosity towards them. I feel sorry for them. I really feel sorry for them. So anyhow, we started speaking out. So eventually, Glenn and I sat down and composed a letter, and we had a friend that was on the conference committee, and he gave us all the names and addresses of the conference committee and told them that we could no longer support them with our offerings and tithe. First it was just a tithe, and then we had to add offerings. One, we could no longer support heresy in the pulpit. We could no longer support lawsuits against our other brethren. And with tithe money, and using a Catholic lawyer to do it. We could no longer support the stock markets. When I first went to the General Conference, I had money in the stock markets. Oh, Sister Ann, you don't want to do that. That's not right. Well, they were doing it all the time. Hospitals accepting government money. I just listed four. The letter contained eight reasons why we could no longer support it. And different ones would say to me, oh, Ann, you don't have to worry about that. We give them their tithe money, and that's what they do with it. It's their fault. And my question is, wait a minute, if I have a neighbor and he's in need and I'm giving him money and he is not spending that money on something, things that he needs, but alcohol, should I continue to support him? No. In the same way applies to us, because when you give money to the conference, to the General Conference, it's not being used as you think it is. And they have these little ways of switching Robin Peter to pay Paul and stuff like that. And it's just not good. So we had a meeting at the church, our last meeting with the organized church. was the second Sabbath of 1986. We didn't say anything to the people there that were opposed to us. We just simply went to church, came out, and we all met over at my place. I got out on the parking lot, and I'm getting ahead of myself. Not only couldn't we hold office, but we had no, later they added to that, we had no voice. No voice. But the final, which broke the camel's back, the final straw that broke the camel's back, they told us we couldn't give Bible studies. Now you tell me, what human being has the right to tell you you can't have a Bible study? And so we said, that's it. That was it. So we got out on the parking lot, and there was a young lady, and she had an envelope for me. And I knew what it was. Her mother would send us money from time to time. It was usually thousands. And this particular time, when she came out, when she gave it to me, I said to her, I says, Kathy, if you want, I'll take it in and put it back in the offering. She says, no. It's to start over. Amen. It was $2,360. God provided. So anyhow, we got back here and kind of got my house rearranged a little bit so we could have the next Sabbath. We would meet at our house for Sabbath school and church. And we were there starting the third Sabbath of October until June of 87. Now, how many months is that? October to June. 7 months. 7 months. There was a young man there, and this Angie that I was talking about, her husband wasn't a Christian. We had a meeting after Sabbath, and her husband says, now I know I'm not a member, but I pledge $1,000. I can't give it all to you right now, but I will put $1,000 towards it. So by the grace of God, the first part of this ministry was built. This building was built. We had the sanctuary, the two Sabbath school rooms, a kitchen that wasn't finished, but a kitchen, and the foyer. And then a year or so later, we had some family come in from South Carolina. And they saw that we didn't have bathrooms, we had a path. We didn't have a bath, we had a path. And so, anyhow, they went ahead and wrote out a check that we could get our bathrooms. And so I can see time and time again how God has led. And then later on, Alan comes to me and he says, our first meeting in this building was August of 1987. And Alan came to me later and he says, Ann, what we need's a newsletter. And I said, Alan, there's so many newsletters out there, it's pitiful. He says, but this one's going to be different. He says, this is going to have the truth and we're going to reach Adventists. But we built this place in phases. We never went in debt the first time in building this. So it goes to show you've got to have a vision. And you know, if you're not moving forward, you're either going backwards or you are stagnant. And so there is nothing too hard for God. He has seen us through a lot.
Testimony. Zachariah Beachy. Here you go, brother. You can stand to the side if you want.
Okay, I'll do that. One day, my dad told me to go do something, but it was pouring outside, and I couldn't quite do that thing. So I opened the door, and immediately it stopped raining. So I went and did what Dad told me to do, and then I walked inside, shut the door, and then immediately it started raining. And that's all.
Y'all be back here today.
Well, I just like to give a real short, brief testimony. Some of you know I couldn't read for years. I just really thank God. Oh, I'm sorry.
Just hold it.
Oh, okay. I just like to, maybe I should just repeat what I said before. I just like to, for those that know, I couldn't read for a long time, those that know me, but I just like to thank God that I can read now. Amen. And other major improvement, I mean, I was so bad I couldn't even tie my shoes for till I was like 20 years old. And I believe it was
prayer,
but also I believe it was autism, as you call it. And I just like to praise God. And I know people were praying for me, and I just thank God for your prayers.
Amen.
I have a question.
Yes.
What was your chief book that you read?
The Bible. I just picked up the Bible and I just started reading. And old paths and other hard things, hard books, and I started reading. And so.
That's all right.
Amen.
Amen.
Someone else, and by the way, just so you know, this microphone is not for sound amplification in this room. We don't have any speaker system in here. This is simply for the video feed and for the recordings. But that's why we have to sort of hold it up. Who else? Someone else, I'm sure. We have a lot of faces, and they don't look like they're interested in coming up.
I need to make a statement.
Well, you need to come up here and make it.
Okay. Now, Sister Ford, bless her heart, and her family and her influence. Now I don't know that much about it, but your influence and your witnessing has not only been right in this area, but it has gone down as far as McDowell County. Missionary work has started the work.
Really? Bible school there.
Okay, but what I'm pointing to is your work was started in Kimball, and because of people and all the attrition with money or whatever it is, they have a beautiful little church in Kimball, but very few members. Mm-hmm. And the appeal that you made for workers to come in this area to do the work of the Lord, I hope deaf ears. You need people to come work here, but the work. It's not easy here. You know, when you got to walk up so many steps and so many yards and all, it's very difficult. And if I was a younger man, I would be glad to do that.
Until you go to Welch and see the topography of Welch, it's hard to appreciate that.